Nathan, did there end up...
Lillian, you got a question?
Yeah, did there... Sorry if it's a little bit delayed. Hopefully people can hear me okay. The sound quality is kind of going in and out. But I wanted to know if there was very much sharing of families across. Did the students kind of start to share content and ideas? I mean, I know you said that you would present something in class and students would kind of start doing a lot of that. But did they kind of organically start sharing stuff? Or how did that work?
And I think Matt and Dan might be able to speak to this a little bit more directly on what they may have seen in labs. But the way the submissions were handled and the way, you know, stuff was, I think I think the framework for sharing was there. And, in fact, it was in some ways forced sharing where, you know, every week there would be a progress submission to Dropbox and everyone could see everyone's work that is being posted to that Dropbox. So they're sharing things like models, PDF submissions. I actively discouraged to keep their work in a box for themselves. And the idea was that we wanted to make sure that everyone was exposed, everyone's work was exposed to each other. And it wasn't a surprise when you, at the end, at the final submission, you kind of knew how students had already evolved, and we didn't want to have surprises. So that actually the better projects were the ones that you may not have, you know, shared content with each other directly, but the better projects, I think, were the ones that shared more of their work or more actively and enthusiastically participated in those progress submissions or you know, had their work, you know, after we would go through all their work, had their work displayed as being exemplary examples of where the work was headed overall. Go ahead.
There is no cheating. It's kind of cheating encouraged, looking over your neighbor's shoulder encouraged. I love it.
I think that go ahead.
Okay, like in the lab aspect, there was never any you never saw like an exact family given to another person. That never did happen. But the knowledge on how to build a similar component, that was happening all the time. Because, you know, Dan and I go around and we can get to some, but in the meantime, they're answering their own questions. I heard about some of them doing study groups where they all worked together and then came up, and they all had very different projects. It's not like they got together and made one thing. That it was neat because they were sharing knowledge rather than specific elements.
Yeah,
that's exactly it. Matt, you hit it right in the nose. I mean, we can only get to so many students and spend so much time that when students were getting it, you know, you'd ask that student to help out your neighbor, and there was technique sharing every day in class, and it was really cool to see.
So you guys were all kind of in the same, well, we saw the picture of the class, right? So you were kind of, the class was in the same physical location. So some of the questions that have come in have been about, you know, could this be offered as an online class? I mean, I assume that it's not, this was just offered as a UNL class and it's not online right now, but what do you think about this being offered as an online class? Like, could there be, I mean, I could certainly see, you know, digital content. I could certainly see easy ways of sharing it, but it sounds like the, you know, the interaction between the students is also an important part of that. Kind of how do you foster that online?
Yeah, so I think in some ways the class was a mix of being somewhat virtual, but I think the direct interactions between, you know, the direct day-to-day interactions that the students had with their TAs, like Dan and Matt, were absolutely critical for them to push their projects to the next level. And then, like, the in-person lectures on Monday nights and having that connection, you know, with me directly was important. But, you know, recognizing that the group out there, you know, I would always like to start off my Monday night lectures with just a discussion maybe, or like some anecdotes on social media. I think we had an extended conversation one Monday night just on, you know, Pinterest, what I didn't like about it. and, you know, a lot of them were like, you know, super enthusiastic about the idea of Pinterest, the notion that they're putting up stuff that they liked and having, you know, other people, like, share it across. In some ways, I would put these out there as just provocations, but they were also very comfortable with interacting, I think, when I wasn't in Lincoln, physically in Lincoln, Nebraska, when I was, you know, in Omaha or when I was traveling around. There was a super high level of comfort of, you know, posting stuff to Dropbox and getting my feedback on it, emailing me, and things of that nature. I think we even ran, I think it happened, it inevitably happened always once during a semester where I happened to be in New York or some other part of the States, and we would do a webinar like this as part of the evening lecture. And so there, I feel like there is an exceptionally high level of comfort with, you know, the online nature of what this course could be, but I don't think that could at all replace the day-to-day interactions that you would have with experts, especially when it comes to these kind of open-ended problems.
Yeah, that's a really interesting subject, I think, for educators. Interesting dilemma. One question that also came in is, did you ever discuss how to transition a concept into a constructible design within the modeling environment? Did, I guess, one other thing?
That wasn't really the scope of this class. Given that these are, you know, the notion of constructibility, if they were going to design like a building and have it up to, you know, certain code, we didn't really focus on any of that. This was in many ways purely about a technical exploration of digital design concepts, and I think design thinking when it came to, you know, creatively solving problems with some of these techniques. They're going to have the rest of their college career to really get into, through their studios and with their other instructors, to get into a lot of these nuanced and complex concerns about actually how they realize designs like this. So, in some ways, the scope of the class was already extremely large. We're talking about digital representation, we're talking about drawing, we're talking about presentation, how to communicate ideas. But when it comes to the actual, and technological concepts, when it comes to like technical concepts, that's something that, you know, they have quite a long road ahead of them to really get pegged down. This class is about, I think, giving them the weapons to deal with those problems as they, you know, continue to learn about architecture and interior design and landscape.
Mm-hmm. Another question that came in from Scott Erdy, I think this is kind of related to what you're just talking about, of Erdy McHenry Architecture, and it's kind of long, but I'm just gonna read it here. So, we are trying to implement Revit and Vasari from the beginning of our projects. The struggle has been working conceptually using very soft format while trying to maintain quantitative tracking of the design. Much of our frustration is likely due to many of the Revit tools not being intuitive. Can you comment on implementation of a conceptual building design process with regard to the tools to be used? For instance, your webinar talks about adaptive components at a highly detailed level. How might adaptive components be tied to specific environmental site data while simultaneously tracking program data?
Wow, that's a really loaded question. I'm going to try my best to pick it apart and give many answers to parts of that. Number one, I want to tackle the question on intuitive and what that really means. And as I think that was, you know, that is super relevant to, you know, the work of this class. And you know, I see, you know, clients dealing with this all the time about what's intuitive and what isn't. I think that, you know, given that the students in some ways are coming in with a blank slate, they know 3D modeling, they may have taken a design course in high school, they may know some technical aspects of some more advanced modeling. As I mentioned, I mean, there were students that came into the class like, hey, I know Inventor and SolidWorks and all this stuff really well. I had it in my shop class, or I had, you know, SketchUp, of course, was you know, everywhere, like, oh yeah, you know, I've been using SketchUp since middle school, because that program has democratized the notion of you know, who has access to 3D modeling capabilities, right? But beyond that, like, my observation, and Matt and Dan, you can kind of jump on here as well, but since these people were starting in some ways from square one, they were able to be challenged with concepts such as the relationship of the adaptive component or modeling an adaptive component in the family environment and then how that can become instantiated in a project environment. They're able to be challenged with notions of parameters and things like this because they really didn't know any other way of doing it. And so having in some ways that kind of wide-eyed blank slate, I think allowed them to grasp onto some of these things much more quickly than had they been for lack of a better term, indoctrinated in a certain way of working already. That part was interesting to me. Now, they did struggle a little bit going from, say, modeling a project in Rhino, which is completely open-ended, free-form modeling, to then having to deal with a parametric framework. That there was a struggle there. But that struggle, I don't think, was from the standpoint of necessarily the tool, the differences in the tools, but it was a kind of a struggle in the differences and in kind of getting a handle on the differences in concepts. I am being parametric now, and all my changes and information is being tracked through an entire system. So once they got a handle on that, then they have their freedom again, are able to kind of really explore a wide variety of options in that constraint.
Yeah, it was like the comfort zone kind of factor.
Yeah.
When we first started, it was like after we had done Rhino and then we went into Revit, they're like, well, I can't just model this in Rhino. I know how to do that. Well, yeah, but you're supposed to learn, you know, this is to help expand your thoughts, so we don't want to just copy that in. So that's
right.
What I'm going to add.
Yeah, I think in some ways I feel like intuitive is a code word for comfortable in some cases. In some cases, yeah, you can argue, okay, it is easier and more straightforward in this environment to do it, but it's not as... But I think it also kind of comes down to getting into a comfort zone and wanting to stick there, where this class was really about, I think, pulling the rug out from under people and making sure that they are constantly engaging new issues when it comes to the tools that they're using. The other side of the equation, and this is kind of where the technical half of that question comes into play, I think. You know, we introduced a very narrow selection of Revit in this, in some ways to limit the palette, as Revit has so much stuff in there that if you were to go into it for the first time, it's going to be completely overwhelming to a new user. And so in some ways, the assignments intention was to limit that palette to be, okay, you're going to be using adaptive components, conceptual massing, and pattern-based panels, and then really working within that constraint, and that's going to be the lens for you to understand your experience in the program, right? And then new things can kind of, as you begin to learn more and more about the program, can kind of begin to fill into that. But in some ways, the limiting of the palette is important. And so when it comes to those other questions, you know, is there kind of a recommendation, I think, for getting kind of these feedback loops that you're looking for between kind of environmental analysis and what the right tool is? In some ways, I think there is something to be said by, you know, limit your palette and try it out. I think there's a lot of opportunities, you know, if you're to use like a, you know, adaptive component to start to kind of be the basis in a way for like a programmatic element, right, a program block that has a certain kind of width and depth, or a family that has those kinds of parameters, and then they're using these to kind of iterate through. Lily, I'll point to your example of that quick Python script a while back that let you instantiate numerous instances of a family with different parameters to control things like, you know, volume.
Right.
I think if there's a lesson learned here, it's about, you know, being able to define what that process is first, and then find the right tools to facilitate it.
Mm-hmm.
I have no idea if I answered the second part of the question, right?
No, I think that's this has all been really, really fascinating. We are unfortunately out of time, but thank you guys so much for your work in putting this class together and for inspiring this new generation of students and all of us in turn to see the possibilities of these tools. And we will be recording this session, so pass it on to your friends. I think it's been a really, really interesting one, and we will be back in 2 weeks. I believe our friends from Green Building Studio are going to join us again, but stay tuned to audiosvasari.com for news of our next webinar. And thanks again, guys, for joining us, and we will talk to everybody soon. Take care.
Thanks. It's been a pleasure. Thanks for the chance,
Lily.
Okay. Thanks so much.
Thank you, guys.
Bye-bye.